Hi guys, welcome back to The Social Tune. So, one of my most popular videos on this channel has been the top 10 songs that I should hate but don't. Apparently people really like to see me laying myself bare, and admit that my opinion, while certainly better than most, isn't entirely without its faults. Well, the other fun thing about opinions is that not only are they subjective, but they're also prone to change. At one stage of your life, a song could really speak to you, but as the years go by, you could start to notice how corny or even bad the song in question truly is. That doesn't mean the song's changed, it means you have, which is only natural. Today though, we're going to be looking at the opposite. Because there are songs that I used to truly despise, which, as time has gone on, have managed to strike a chord with me. Sometimes for good reason, where I've noticed the value of the track in question, sometimes it's simply because I came to see it in a different light, and sometimes it's just as terrible as ever, but I have learned to like it. It happens. So let's dive in. These are the top 10 songs that I used to hate, but don't anymore, starting with... Number 10. So originally, this spot was supposed to go to Jason Mraz's I'm Yours, a song that used to annoy the hell out of me. And still does. I'm yours. Yeah, I thought I was over my distaste for this song, but my god, it still irritates me to no end. More on that in another video, but for the time being, I guess these guys have earned themselves a little bit of respite. Just like Will Smith. That girl is a real crowd, please. Small world, all the friends know of me. Yeah, every single other music critic has said it, and I fully agree. Ray Sherman's biggest hit is probably also their best. With the obvious exception of Powerglide. But boy, did I not think that to begin with. Smoke in the air, binge drinking. They lose it when the DJ drops the knee. When I first saw this at number one, I very nearly had a fit. Why the hell are we promoting one of the worst duos in hip-hop this much for a stupid challenge? I'll fully admit that both the song's success and its title made it very hard for me to cut it any slack. Because even in hindsight, this isn't exactly stellar. With forgettable verses and a well-produced and catchy, but not exactly groundbreaking chorus. However, it was just catchy and just well-produced enough to really grow on me throughout 2017. To the point where it very nearly became one of my favorite hit songs of that year, especially because of Swae Lee. I'm a fucking black beetle, cream seats in the Regal, rocking John Lennon lenses, like to see him spread eagle. I stand by all of my criticisms of this duo. None of their albums deserve more than a 3 out of 10 in my opinion. Their content is generic and boring when it's not being extremely questionable, and countless other rap duos out there can do what they've done a hell of a lot better. Even Gucci Mane manages to tick me off just a little bit with his verse. Like Chapo serving yayo to the gringos. Black Beetle Club clothes when I say so. Really? On a song called Black Beatles? That's really the best rhyme you could come up with for gringos? But I still can't deny how much the song has grown on me, nor how deeply relieved I am that out of all of their songs, this is the one that gets played the most and not... She's dancing like a stripper. Hey. No flex, zone. Dose them up. Yeah. What's it? Dose them up. Any of those atrocities. They lose it when the DJ drops the knee. They lose. Number 9. Okay, this entry is a bit of an odd one for me. True, I did used to hate it, particularly because of the terrible movie it was tied into, but after seeing just how much bile and vitriol it was getting from so many people online, I actually started to feel sorry for it. And over time, that pity became a motherly defensive urge to protect this poor little innocent track that so many people had just torn to shreds throughout 2016. I mean, come on, guys, it's not that bad. So just dance, dance, dance. I I'm not about to argue that this is one of JT's best hits or anything like that. It's a cheesy, upbeat song that's very easy to laugh at and make fun of. However, many people didn't just dislike it, they despised it. And it displays an attitude in music criticism that I have affectionately decided to dub the Andy Grammer Syndrome.
So honey, I'm good. I could have another, but I probably should not.
Yeah, Honey, I'm Good was another song that really seemed to get under people's skin for how upbeat and chipper it was. And don't tell me that it's really because he's bragging about not cheating. After all, in today's pop landscape, that really is something you could legitimately brag about. Because while the lyrics on that song are still definitely questionable, I still think the primary reason that it rubbed so many people the wrong way was because of its big, goofy attitude in the face of an increasingly cynical society. Same story with Happy by Pharrell, although you could also argue the overplay had something to do with it. Well, fuck it, I've never been too cool for cheesy pop music, and personally, I've come to really enjoy all three of these songs.
Nothing I can see but you when you dance, dance, dance. Feel good creeping up on you, so just dance, dance, dance. Come on.
In a pop scene that has become steadily more depressing and drab with each passing year, it's getting steadily easier to dismiss pop fluff like this as completely pointless, when I truly believe that we still need songs like this in the mainstream. Music should reflect our feelings, sure, but songs like this were created to lighten your mood, and I think it's a real shame if our immediate reaction is just to dismiss it all as bad. True, the production isn't the best, but there was far worse released in 2016. We do not speak of that! And unlike Hot Shell Ray, it feels genuinely happy and upbeat, rather than just having Justin cynically roll his eyes at the camera every 2 seconds. I'll always appreciate this sort of optimistic and upbeat pop music, because especially as our world gets steadily more depressing, we need songs like this now more than ever. Once again, by no means the best pop song out there, or even a particularly great one, and I'd certainly take Carly Rae or Kesha over this any day of the week, but they're all essentially pushing the same idea, and this isn't a half bad example of that.
Got this feeling in my body. Come on.
Number 8. I have a weird relationship with Coldplay.
Cause you're a sky, cause you're a sky full of stars.
I love Viva La Vida, Speed of Sound, and Something Just Like This, but songs like Paradise, Clocks, and Yellow bore me to tears. The only songs from them that I've ever truly hated are from their 2015 release, Head Full of Dreams. In fact, this spot was originally meant to go to Adventure of a Lifetime. But while I can't say that I loathe that song as much as I used to, I can't exactly say I'm a big fan of it either. Then I remembered, oh yeah, this was a hit a couple of years ago. When I first heard this, all I could do was roll my eyes and groan. Really? Coldplay is so desperate to be relatable that they're making a song about getting drunk and high? Yeah, I believe that, especially with how earnest and pseudo-deep so much of their material is. Hell, even now, this definitely feels like an outlier among their discography. So, what changed for me? Well, honestly, once I took Coldplay out of the equation, I actually found quite a lot to like about this song. Whether it be the great, uncredited backing vocals from Beyoncé, or the way the horns blend so well with Chris Martin's vocals on the pre-chorus, or the soaring chorus itself, which is so blissful and elated. It's a tumbling, triumphant song that fills you with a good feeling, and one that's really hard to deny whenever it gets played at a party. Heck, the more I hear from Chris Martin, the more I think that this is the kind of music that he's always wanted to make. He just seems like a chill guy who wants to make chill music at this stage of his life. And considering he still manages to make it fun and upbeat, I can't really bring myself to deny the song any longer. Number 7. Yeah, I have no excuse for this one.
Yeah, we got the fire, 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 and we're gonna let it burn, 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 burn. We're gonna let it burn, 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 burn.
No joke. joke. Like I said before, I used to hate this with, for lack of a better term, a burning passion. Which is kind of embarrassing because it's arguably the best song on this entire list. I mean, with the exception of Lights, this is easily her best hit, so what gives? Well, funny enough, you could trace the blame for my dislike of this song back to Lights. I loved that song, so when she decided to follow it up with the far inferior I Need Your Love with Calvin Harris, I was deeply disappointed. So when this came out, all I could hear was her doubling down on that electronic sound, rather than the ethereal beauty of her first big hit. However, over time, I've realized just how wrong I was. When the lights turn down, they'll know what they heard. Funny enough, I still wouldn't quite call this a fantastic song. Definitely a great one, but I think that the chorus can be a little bit repetitive, especially with all of that vocal compression. But the pre-chorus verses and overall instrumental are utterly gorgeous, especially with those bells that I really have grown to love. And now I can easily admit that it's one of my favorite Ellie Goulding songs, as well as one of the best pop songs of 2014. We can light it up, 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 so they can put it out. Sometimes, distance is good for a song, and once you stop comparing it to better examples, you may find that it's still damn great in its own right. I Need Your Love still sucks, though. Yeah, I said it! Who wants some? Yeah, we got the fire, 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 and we're gonna let it burn. Number 6. So far, I think I've given pretty good explanations for all of these. None of these songs just magically changed for me overnight, they all gradually took their time to grow on me, with one exception. Yeah, I bet you could never guess how old I am right now. But as dumb as it may be, on my 22nd birthday, I played this song, and all the hatred, scorn, and resentment that I had harbored for it for years just dissipated in one go. Maybe because, at the tender age of 22, I can completely relate to this. We're happy, free, confused, and lonely at the same time. It's optimistic, it's cheesy, it's over the top. But it's also kind of sarcastic and tongue-in-cheek. However, all of that playful sarcasm comes from a genuine place within Taylor. I genuinely believe that she wanted to make an anthem for the 22-year-olds of the world. And once I reached that milestone, I deeply appreciated it. I don't know if I'm gonna wake up on my 23rd birthday and hate this, but I sure hope not, because right now, this song's miserable magic really works for me, and I really do hope it lasts. That's all I've got, and that's really all there is to it. Next song. Number 5. Drake. Are you riding? Say you never ever leave from beside me. I've complained a lot about this guy on my channel. The overly long albums, the ego, the whining self-pity, all of that is pretty damn obnoxious. But what I hate most about Drake is that I can't hate him. I know you special, girl, cause I know too many. Risha, do you love me? Are you riding? I'm not kidding. In terms of his singles, there are very few that I can stay mad at for long. Heck, I was forced to add the one song per artist clause to this list, specifically because if I didn't, half of it would just be Drake. And there were many contenders for this list, from Passion Fruit to 0 to 100 to even Hotline Bling. But if I'm being honest, out of all of Drake's hits, this is by far one of the biggest, and easily one that has grown the most on me over time. That's why I need a one dance, got a Hennessy in my hand. One more time before I go. 2016 was a terrible year for music, and spoilers, this isn't the last song from that year that we will be discussing in this video. With very few exceptions, the music was drab, boring, and uninspired. And one of the biggest was Drake's first ever number one hit, the Afrobeat-inspired One Dance. And to be fair, it's not hard to see why I hated it so much back in the day.
You know you gotta stick by me. Soon as you see the text, reply me. I don't wanna spend time fighting.
Not only is this song pretty disingenuous, with Drake putting on an embarrassing accent and the song itself not having much groove to it, with astoundingly cheap and thin production to boot, but this song was everywhere. You could not escape it. Heck, even now, years later, I still hear it getting played on the radio now and again. However, with a little bit of time and distance, I've actually come to look forward to hearing it every once in a while. It's a little hard to explain. I would rarely seek this song out, but I hear it regularly enough that it's become quite familiar. And when it does come on in a club or in a pub or in a coffee shop, I'm not gonna deny that I light up and start grooving to it. Sure, I still shake my head every single time it comes on because I know that it's not exactly a good song, but it's one that I have come to enjoy despite myself. Much like with Burn, it's a prime example of a little bit of time and distance being good for your relationship with a song, even if it's only in small, separated doses.
One more time for I go, higher powers taking hold on me.
I hate you! I hate you!
Number 4. Okay, I've come to love 22 simply by reaching the age of 22. It may seem dumb and conformative, but frankly, I just don't care. And to be fair, the older you get, the more you will come to change your opinion on a lot of music. Take this song, for example. Some of you may look back on it and wonder how you could have ever loved it to the degree that you did, while I look back on it a little bit differently.
Baby, you light up my world like nobody else. The way that you flip your head gets me overwhelmed.
Now, at least for me, there's a clear distinction between One Direction's good songs and their bad ones. Best Song Ever, Drag Me Down, and Night Changes are all better thought out, better produced, and better written, and are therefore better than some of their earlier work like One Thing and Live While We're Young. However, over time, their biggest hit of 2012 has become a huge exception, and it's a little hard to explain why that is.
You're insecure, don't know what for. You're turning heads when you walk through the door.
The cowbell, the sharp guitar line, the programmed drums, even the over-the-top, almost condescending delivery all really used to piss me off as a teenager. Especially with the backhanded compliment that this girl doesn't even know she's beautiful. I mean, how is that a compliment? But at the time, I'll fully admit that I understood nothing about girls. I barely spoke to them. And having talked to and gotten to know a lot of them very well over the years, especially as an adult, as well as someone who has come to like One Direction a fair bit, I can at least say that I get it now. It's a song coasting off of charisma and charm, sweeping a girl off of her feet and reassuring her that the one thing that she's probably most insecure about is just as lovable to them as everything else about her. Essentially, it's what Little Things was trying to do, except keeping it vague enough to be flattering, and with a much better chorus to boot. Yeah, say what you will about this song, but the hook hits you full force, as they all belt their lungs out and it feels like they put real effort into it. Not to mention, it sounds great, especially on the final chorus after the bridge. Is it corny and kind of manipulative? Yes, of course. But much like the best songs by Backstreet, and yes, even NSYNC, it's the effort and the utter conviction with which it's delivered that makes it so charming. It may not be aimed at me, but over time, it's a song that I've nevertheless learned to appreciate, and now always will.
That's what makes you beautiful.
Number 3. So, while a lot of the songs that I've mentioned so far have been thoroughly disliked by many, I don't think that any of them have been too controversial or too surprising. After all, it's very rare for a music critic to do a complete 180 on a song, and at most, some of the songs that I've mentioned have provoked a 140 or maybe a 150. These last three, on the other hand, are a different story. These aren't just songs I hated, they were terrible songs that I loathed for years. All easy top 10 contenders in the worst hits of their respective years. But out of the three, this is the one that probably has a fair few fans and defenders that I was more than willing to face once I discussed it on a worst list. And yet...
Yeah. I know sometimes things may not always make sense to you right now.
Okay, look, I have a real soft spot for art that reflects the relationship between parents and their kids, a topic which Eminem has dived into a lot. And I'm not gonna lie, whenever he does it, I find it a little bit hard not to cringe. Possibly because he does it so often, but more likely because it's always a tad awkward. And this song is certainly no exception. The bars are overstuffed with too many words, the deadpan delivery can be kind of distracting considering the subject matter, and I'll fully admit that I used to utterly loathe the singing on the hook. But over time, I've come to appreciate the interpolation of that lullaby, as it does show the caring attitude that he has for his daughter, especially on the final hook where Slim Shady briefly resurfaces.
And if the mockingbird don't sing and it ring don't shine, I'ma break that birdie's neck.
That's funny while still not breaking up the tone of the song. It's an element of humor that reminds you of who you're listening to and makes the song feel all the more genuine.
Stiffen that up, pull it up, little lady, I told ya, daddy said I'll hold ya through the night.
And heck, despite being overstuffed, the verses do contain some really potent imagery, showing the struggle that Em and Kim went through trying to raise a daughter in a very tricky situation.
I remember back when you and daddy had no money, mommy wrapped the Christmas presents up and stuck them under the tree and said some of them were from me, cause daddy couldn't buy them.
This is a song that I used to call objectively terrible, and I am so glad I don't think in such black and white terms anymore, because in hindsight, despite its less than favorable reputation, it's probably my favorite out of all of the songs directed at his daughter. Well,
just the two of us, just the two of us.
Almost.
I go back to the jeweler who sold it to ya, and they can meet every carrot, don't f*** with that.
Number 2.
Oh my god, I love you!
Okay, defending a lesser Eminem hit is one thing, but this is going to be a little bit tougher.
We don't talk anymore. We don't talk anymore. We don't talk anymore like we used to do.
Ooh, this is a tricky one for me to talk about. I mean, this is one of the worst hit songs of 2016. One of the worst years for music in recent memory. It topped several worst lists and was my own number 8 pick for that year. It was before Charlie Puth had learned to use his lower range or find production that flattered him. Heck, I still hate other songs from this era like One Call Away or Suffer or Dangerously, so why is this any different?
I just heard you found the one you've been looking, you've been looking for. I wish I would have known that wasn't me.
Well, let me just say that I still recognize that this song has some big problems. The high-pitched tone on the bridge that sounds very out of tune and nasal, the guitar line that was recorded on an iPhone and still sounds incredibly synthetic, Selena Gomez sounding half asleep, and Charlie Puth sounding both too willowy and too mean-spirited and selfish. What could have possibly changed so much in just 2 years that made me feel any sympathy towards a song like this? Well, there are a couple of things. For one, this gets played on Irish radio pretty frequently to this day, and on many late nights out in those quieter moments of reflection, the instrumental has grown on me a lot. For another, while neither Charlie nor Selena sound great on this, they actually work very well opposite each other. Heck, you could argue that the fact that it sounds more amateurish lends it more of a punch. They sound like real dejected people on here. And yeah, I'm not going to deny that the lyrics do ring a little bit closer to home than they did just a couple of years ago.
Now I can't get you out of my brain.
Oh, it's such a shame that we don't talk anymore.
Relationships change you, and sometimes no matter how well you got on beforehand, after they end, it can be impossible to pick up where you left off. It's one of the reasons why I no longer feel angry towards Charlie Puth for his bitterness on this track. No, it's not mature or setting a good example, but it is relatable. It's a state of mind that I may not like, but I do recognize.
We don't love anymore. What was all of it for?
It's not a perfect song, or even a great one by any means, and I'm fairly certain that the depth and place it reached in my heart were entirely accidental. But despite its many problems, I've come to really like it. And for a long time, I was certain that it was going to top this list. But then, I remembered one more song that fit the bill just a little bit better.
We don't talk anymore.
And finally, number one.
Oh my God, I love you.
Now, I know what you're all thinking.
What could possibly top one of the most despised songs that Charlie Puth has ever released? Oh my God!
Well, here's the thing. While We Don't Talk Anymore used to be awful to me, I always recognized that it wasn't Charlie Puth's worst hit. Marvin Gaye is still one of the worst songs of the past decade, and even back then, One Call Away infuriated me more. For many years, though, this song was, in my opinion, the worst thing that this artist had ever released. Heck, it wasn't until 2018, 10 years after its release, that I eventually came around on it. And yes, it's arguably just as terrible as ever, and I would completely understand if someone still said they hated it, but yep. You heard me. Even more than a song like Bon Appetit, I loathed I Kissed a Girl. To the point where, for a long time, it was going to be my pick for the worst hit song of 2008. And before you throw a hissy fit, no, it wasn't because of the idea of girls making out. My issue with it was that Katy was clearly doing it for the controversy, to get a reaction out of people. Heck, on the song, she makes it absolutely clear that she's just thrill-seeking, and that she's not really into girls.
It's not what I'm used to. Just wanna try you on.
It's a song where she gets so blindly drunk that she decides to try you on just to see if she likes it. And originally, that rang as pretty hollow to me. Heck, it still does. Plus, no way around it, Katy has never sounded worse before or since than she does here. Her voice is faltering and cracking all over the place, and the production does her absolutely no favors. With songwriting that's arguably the dumbest it's ever been for her, so why do I love it so much? Well, for me, it's less the song itself that's changed, and more my own attitude towards Katy Perry. I used to be ashamed of my love for Katy Perry songs. I admitted that I really liked them, but I always knew they were just guilty pleasures and that they weren't really that good. But then I decided to make a list of the top 10 best hit songs of 2010 and really analyzed this for the first time. Finally, I had found a Katy Perry song that I could fully defend and love, not just as a dumb, fun song, but a genuinely terrific one. And over time, I've revisited all of her hits from the 2010s and found that I love pretty much all of them.
Baby, you're a firework.
Anthemic as hell.
Think we kissed, but I forgot.
One of the best written and most enjoyable party songs of all time.
See, I'm a
Okay, that one's bad, but it's so enjoyably bad. Sure, there were a couple of exceptions, like Dark Horse or Chained to the Rhythm, but that's honestly because she was trying too hard on them. In my opinion, Katie is one of those artists who works best when she throws herself into a song without a safety net, not caring about what people thought of her, which both of those songs were clearly obsessed with. This brings us back to I Kissed a Girl, a song about shamelessly making out with a girl in public just for fun. She doesn't care if it's provocative, she doesn't care who this girl is, she doesn't even care what we as an audience may think of her for dragging this girl into her experimental game. And my god, is it everything I love about her music.
Us girls, we are so magical, soft skin, red lips, so kissable.
Don't get me wrong, this isn't up there with her best, it's no Hot and Cold or California Girls, but it has the same attitude as those songs that I've come to love and respect so damn much. Not to mention a chorus that deserves to become a staple of any karaoke night. So yeah, once again, Katy Perry, you've gotten me to praise you. God bless you and your wonderful pop classics too. So thank you guys for watching. Leave a like if you enjoyed. Not gonna lie, this list was an absolute blast to both write and film. So I really do hope that you all had about as much fun as I did. Feel free to leave your thoughts on it and how awful my opinions are down in the comments below, as well as any hits that you used to hate but have come around on. Otherwise, please subscribe and hit that notification bell so you don't miss a thing. And until the next time, I'm Finn, and this is The Social Tune, signing off.